Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. First up, I feature this article every year, and it's always fun to see the progress being made. And this is Apple's use of Swift in SwiftUI in iOS 18. And I've been tracking this for 5 or 6 years now, and I mean, spoiler alert, right? We all know this, that yes, Apple itself is adopting Swift and SwiftUI more and more over the years. It's just nice to see some numbers to that. And of course, the author says, like, you know, definitely check out the methodology. This is not a perfect method, right? We're not inside Apple. We don't fully know. But you can see that they analyze binaries to see, you know, what uses Swift, what uses Swift UI, what uses Objective-C or UIKit. And something to keep in mind, right? An app containing a single line of Swift code will be counted as using Swift. So take this with a grain of salt, but it's meant to be like directionally correct, right? The exact percentages may not be correct, but again, directionally correct. They go over the number of binaries that are growing here, but what you want to see is Swift and SwiftUI. Unsurprisingly, the number of apps adopting SwiftUI continues to grow this year. Notable mentions, right? The new passwords app, Siri, the calculator app that got revamped, the journal app. And if we go down to some of the fun charts here, right, you can see the trend of number of binaries using Swift in the dark orange and SwiftUI, which again was only introduced in iOS 13, slowly growing here in the light orange. If we keep scrolling down to more of these charts here, let's scroll down the programming languages. Yes, of course, Objective-C still dominates because it's got, you know, 20, 30 years of history built up into Apple. You know, Swift only came along a decade ago. But you can see Swift's percentage slowly growing each and every year. And then we have the UIKit versus SwiftUI, which actually let's back up to the Objective-C versus Swift because I started learning this when Swift first came out. And the questions you're all having, should I learn UIKit? Should I learn SwiftUI? It was the same questions, just should I learn Objective-C? Should I learn Swift? And the same logic applied. It was like, oh, all the existing apps are in Objective-C. It's gonna take a while for Swift to get adopted. But look, 10 years later, that's not even a question, right? No one's asking, should I learn Objective-C or should I learn Swift? That doesn't mean Objective-C is useless, but you know, the trend is clear. And I believe we're basically there with SwiftUI as well. Like, of course, you still need to know UIKit. Of course, so many apps use UIKit. But I think, you know, in a few years, the question of SwiftUI or UIKit will be just as silly as the question right now of, should I learn Objective-C or Swift? Again, to be clear, that is not to say Objective-C and UIKit are useless. It's just, again, where the future is going is very clear. And every year, we get to see the progress here, right? Binaries using SwiftUI or UIKit only. So you can see, and this is Apple, remember. This isn't just apps on the App Store. This is Apple's internal use, just slowly adopting SwiftUI over time. And again, you fast forward 5, 10 years, I just believe Swift and SwiftUI will be super dominant. I mean, Swift is already dominant, but SwiftUI will be there as well. Next up, we have the App Store Award winners from Apple for 2024. And I also feature this article every year because my recommendation is always the same. These are what Apple deemed to be some of the best apps on the App Store this year. So if you're creating apps, I highly encourage you to go through this list and download each of these apps. Play with them. See what makes an award-winning app from Apple. So the iPhone app of the year was Kino. If you're familiar with the Halide app or the Spectre app, camera app, Kino is their video app and that one app of the year. So download Kino, play with it. Look at the UI, look at the interactions, see what it's doing. Even if you're not building a camera app or a video app, you can still pick up little inspiration here and there for how they do certain things. So anyway, I'm not gonna like scroll through and point out all the winners, but again, my advice always remains the same. Go through, download all these apps, play with them, see what makes an Apple award-winning apps, and take some notes. Moving on, we're talking about Swift 6 concurrency and improving the approachability of Swift 6 concurrency. Because just like we talked about a little bit ago with like Swift and SwiftUI and like the direction things are going, Swift 6 concurrency is brand new, but again, fast forward 3, 5, 7 years from now, it's gonna be commonplace. So if you haven't started learning it yet, I recommend diving in, and this could be a good time because Apple has realized like, hey, this might not have been very approachable, so they're gonna work on improving that. And that is what this whole, it's not called a manifesto, but what do they call it? They have like a term for it. I can't remember, a vision document or something like that. Like to give the vision of where Swift 6 concurrency is going. So right now it had 3 goals, right? Extend memory safety guarantees to low-level data races, like that was the goal. But also maintain progressive disclosure for non-concurrent code. And here's the thing, make basic use of concurrency simple and easy. And they admit the Swift 6 language mode provides a baseline correctness that meets the first goal, safety from data races, but sometimes it comes at the cost of the second. And anyone that's tried to dive into Swift 6 concurrency, especially on a large existing project, really feels that. So that's what this whole document is. So if you are in the world of Swift 6 concurrency, you're diving in, definitely take a read through here. They're going to go through and think of ways to improve the approachability. And some of this is making it easy to use single-threaded code, because not all apps need concurrency. And they even say in the document, they kind of defaulted that all apps would need concurrency. And so for the apps that don't need it, this just overcomplicates things. So that's just one example of things they're addressing. So I recommend diving in. It's a long, look, I'll scroll fast. It's a very long document, code samples. So it'll take some time to read through and dive in. But like I said, if you've already started Swift 6 concurrency and you're kind of confused, give this a look. There might be some bright spots on the horizon of making it more approachable and certainly less of a pain to adopt. And speaking of adopting Swift 6 concurrency, here's a great conversation here with Matt Massicott, who talks about in this video how he, you know, didn't really know anything about concurrency, and he really dove in and learned, and eventually, you know, he wrote the Swift 6 migration guide on swift.org. So very knowledgeable about it. I've seen him give a talk at Deep Dish Swift in Chicago. Good stuff. But this is a good conversation. It's only about a half hour about migrating to Swift 6. And should you even migrate, right? Because if you have a large existing code base, Matt says, like, you need to have a very good reason to adopt Swift 6. Like, you're just asking for so many headaches if your app is working and you don't really need to. Again, on a large existing code base. But talk about the pros and cons of that, learning Swift 6, how you think your code is working, you think you understand concurrency, and then you flip on Swift 6 language mode, the compiler mode, and then you get, you know, 1,000 warnings, 1,000 errors that really show you, like, oh, I was using concurrency completely incorrectly. So anyway, I thought it was a great conversation. Again, if you're making that dive into Swift 6 concurrency, definitely check this out. Up next, we got Bruno Rocha with focus not on the task, but on the problem behind the task. And I like this message to all engineers. And to sum it up, I mean, obviously go check out the article, read through it. But the point here is, like, you know, if you're working on a team, whether it's a small startup or a large corporation, a lot of times you'll get direction from, you know, the product manager, or if it's a small startup, the CEO might want something, or marketing might want something. And it's your job as the engineer to at least stop, think about the bigger picture. Don't just blindly do what you're told to do, is kind of the gist. And here's some questions to do. It's like, focus on the problem behind the task, right? Some example questions like, who's asking for this? Does anyone actually need this? Because sometimes it'll be like one customer made a complaint, and you really got to dig in to find out if it's something you should build. Because remember, developer resources are probably some of the most expensive resources, you know, in the company, in the startup, whatever it is. So, you know, did someone attempt to solve this before? If so, what did they try? Like, who's going to benefit from this ask being executed? How would they use a solution? Again, the point is, don't just blindly do, take a step back. That's your job as the engineer, especially a senior engineer. Like he talks about this book specifically for staff level engineers. Staff level engineers should have this mastered, but even if you're not, you know, you're junior, you're up and coming, especially if you're at a small startup, because you may only be one of two engineers. And, you know, like I said, the CEO might ask for something, the marketing team may ask for something. And it's your job to kind of be that filter to be like, wait a minute, do we really need to build this? What is the actual problem, right? Because, you know, some users may ask for a feature, but that's not really solving the core problem. Finding out what the user's core problem is, then it's up to you to decide, you know, what feature to build. Let me rephrase that. It's up to you to at least push back and present a better solution, right? It may be out of your control what actually gets built, right? I understand there's levels in the company, but it is your job as an engineer to at least push back and provide another solution if that makes sense. Right. So again, the idea here is don't just blindly build whatever someone tells you to build. Take a step back, look at the problem as a whole, and then, you know, make sure it's the right thing and fight for it if you can. All right, indie dev time. And we got Revenue Cat with the essential guide to paywalls for a subscription app. You know, if you're building an indie app or you have a subscription app, your paywall can make or break you. And here's Revenue Cat with just a bunch of advice. You know, do you want to use your in-house build your own paywall, or do you want to use a third-party paywall? Like, Revenue Cat's got their own paywalls. Superwall has paywalls that you can configure remotely, and there's pros and cons to that. So they talk about all that. And then, you know, the differences between iOS and Android, right? The major differences. There's pricing flexibility. The way they do offers and free trials is different. So you're going to need to know that if you're building on both platforms. The placement, right? Do you do it at the end of onboarding? Yes, is the answer. You should do that, because that's where most conversions happen. But, you know, that may not always be the case for everyone. You have the contextual paywalls. Do you show the paywall when the user tries to use the feature that is actually a pro feature? Then you show the paywall. There's the buy now. There's always that constant button here, you know, the get pro button. Anyway, I could go down this huge long list. The point is, there's tons of dials and experiments you can run on your paywall. And it makes such a huge difference. Like the conversion rate of your paywall, again, can just make or break your product, your startup, anything. It is a big deal, so definitely read this article. Keeping with the indie dev theme here, we have interviews with, sorry, I'm not gonna try to pronounce the surnames, Hidde and Paul, and they build the Helm app, which if you're used to dealing with the nightmare of a website that is App Store Connect, here's a native Mac app that uses that API to be a much, much nicer experience when you're submitting apps to the App Store. But I always love hearing developers talk about their process and how they think about things, especially someone like Hidde, who has a background in design and then taught himself how to code. Like I love that intersection of design and code, and Hidde builds beautiful apps. So if nothing else, download Helm just to check out a beautifully made Mac app. And there's a link in the description to Helm. It is an affiliate link, but this isn't like sponsored or anything like that. But anyway, like I said, the interview talks about how you come up with the idea, how do you generate other ideas, you know, what's your day-to-day development like, how do you launch and market your app? Like here's a screenshot of Helm. You know, what is the future plans for your app? All this stuff. Again, I won't go too deep into it, but if you're interested in other indie devs' process, how they get ideas, how they make their apps, how they think about their products, definitely give this article a read. Lastly, we have Navigating Pitfalls from Create with Swift, the do's and don'ts of gestural interfaces. It runs through and talks about how a lot of gestures like the swipe and the scroll and the pull to refresh are very intuitive and commonplace in apps, that no problem using those. But when you start to add like, you know, three finger swipes or three finger pinch to zoom, right? Like I've owned an iPhone since 2008. I don't think I've ever three finger swiped on anything on my phone, right? That's not something I think to do. But something more common is burying like a secondary menu behind like a long press, like long press on this to pull up a secondary menu. You should almost never do that for primary features, right? If there's another way to get to it and maybe the long press is for power users, right? That's like a secondary way, fine. But here's the truth. If you put something behind like a long press or a long tap, 85% of your users are never going to see it. And that's kind of the gist of this article here, is being careful what gestures you use and kind of not reinventing the wheel. And also being careful that some of these gestures you might try to use might override some of the accessibility gestures that are out there. So again, if you're thinking about using custom gestures for navigation or any other gestures in your app, definitely give this article a read, and it just might talk you out of being too clever. And if you're here learning about the latest and greatest in iOS development and Swift news, I know you're trying to build amazing apps, and I always recommend having an awesome iOS developer portfolio website to showcase your work so people can see what you can do. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're developers, we can build a website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you want to spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you want to spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and analytics for you. Again, Squarespace handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.